I'm going to leave this with you because this is just going to distract me while I try and preach a sermon. Y'all, happy Father's Day. It's a great privilege to be a father. I know I lost my dad when I was quite young. I was 13 years old, so I know that a day like today can be a bittersweet day. But happy Father's Day to the fathers. God meets us where we're at, and he is good and gracious and kind to us. So praise the Lord for that. Cool, so it's a real joy to be opening God's Word with you this morning. And we're continuing, as Lex mentioned, in our series in the book of Romans. This morning we're focusing on the first 12 verses of chapter 4. But in order for us to fully grasp what Paul is saying in chapter 4, we need to take into account what he said in chapter 3. It's not a new thought that comes into chapter 4. It's a follow-on from chapter 3. And so last week, Kyle did a brilliant job of taking us through a smaller section in chapter 3 from verse 21 to 26. And if you haven't had a chance to listen to that, may I strongly suggest that you do. It was brilliant. But he looked at how God sees our guilt. He sees our sin, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And yet he freely justifies us through the redemption that came by Jesus Christ. And the fact is that God has satisfied his righteous requirement for justice by pouring out his wrath on Jesus. And in doing this, he showed mercy to sinners, taking away our unrighteousness and giving us his righteousness. Okay, it's a beautiful thing. And Paul, in 2 Corinthians 5:12, actually writes this. He frames it this way. He says, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. This is a gift that is to be received by faith. It is not something that we can earn. And you're just going to hear me bang on that drum throughout this message. I'm probably going to sound like a stuck record, but that's fine. The cross shows that God is both just and merciful, and that we are recipients of his mercy and grace through faith and not through our works. Now, it's a wonderful thing to know this, right? It's a wonderful thing to have the head knowledge of this, to understand this. This is a life-changing truth. So it's good to know this, but it's another thing entirely to have this affect our lives, to have this affect how we live day to day. So Paul's not just satisfied with giving us the theory of the gospel. He really wants to drive home the point. And he does this by giving us practical examples of real people who experienced or who received God's justification through faith. And this is what he does in chapter 4. So if you have your Bible, please open up with me to Romans. We're actually going to start just towards the end of chapter 3. So we'll start in verse 27 of chapter 3. And let's read. Romans 3:27. Where then is boasting? It is excluded. Because of what law? The law that requires works? No, because of the law that requires faith. For we maintain that a person is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. Or is God the God of Jews only? Is he not the God of Gentiles too? Yes, of Gentiles too. Since there is only one God who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through the same faith. Do we then nullify the law by this faith? Not at all. Rather, we uphold the law. And in chapter 4, what then shall we say that Abraham, our forefather according to the flesh, discovered in this matter? If, in fact, Abraham was justified by works, he had something to boast about, but not before God. What does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Now, to the one who works, wages are not credited as a gift, but as an obligation. However, to the one who does not work, but trusts God who justifies the ungodly, their faith is credited as righteousness. David says the same thing when he speaks of the blessedness of the one to whom God credits righteousness apart from works. Blessed are those whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord will never count against them. Is this blessedness, verse 9, is this blessedness only for the circumcised? Also for the uncircumcised. We have been saying that Abraham's faith was credited to him as righteousness. Under what circumstances was it credited? Was it after he was circumcised or before? It was not after, but before. And he received circumcision as a sign, a seal of the righteousness that he had by faith, while he was still uncircumcised. So then, he is the father of all who believe, but have not been circumcised, in order that righteousness might be credited to them. And he is then also the father of the circumcised, who not only are circumcised, but who also follow in the footsteps of the faith that our father Abraham had before he was circumcised. There's a lot of circumcision going on here, so I'm going to need God's help. So let's pray. Lord Jesus, we just come before you and we're so grateful for your kindness and your mercy towards us, Lord. We thank you that you've taken us from our mess and our sin and you've brought us into your family. You've adopted us into your family and you've taken our unrighteousness off us and you've placed your righteousness, you've placed Jesus's righteousness on us, Lord. And I pray that as we go through your word this morning, that you would help us to mix this message with faith. I pray that you would etch it deep into our hearts, that we would truly believe you, that we would trust you, that we would put our faith in you, and that you would so continue to work in us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So, like I said, what we see in chapter 4 of Romans are Old Testament examples in Father Abraham and in King David of God's righteousness or God's work of justification being freely given and received as a gift and not as a result of them upholding the law or by their good works. And so the first point is simply this: Abraham believed God. Cool, we're done, we can go. That's the message. No, in verses 1-3, let's just recap what he says. What then shall we say that Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh, discovered in this matter? If in fact Abraham was justified by works, he had something to boast about, but not before God. What does the scripture say? Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. You see, Abraham was the father of the Jewish nation, and God made a promise to Abraham in Genesis 15. And if you recall Abraham, who back then was called Abram, his wife Sarah, who was called Sarai, they were childless and were both getting on in age. In fact, when Abraham first encounters God and God speaks to him in Genesis 12, the Bible tells us he was 75 years old, right? And in Genesis 5:15, God promises Abraham that his offspring would be as countless as the stars. Let's actually just take a quick look at it in Genesis 15. It says this: after this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your very great reward. But Abram said, Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless and the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, you have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir. Then the word of the Lord came to him, this man will not be your heir, but a son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir. He took him outside and said, look up at the sky and count the stars, if indeed you can count them. Then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. Abraham believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. Now, it's worth us just pausing, just stopping to look at Abraham for a moment to fully grasp the magnitude of what's going on here and what Paul is saying. And I encourage you to go and look at the account of God meeting with Abraham starting in Genesis 11 and reading through. And as you read that account, you'll notice something. You'll notice that Abraham was far from perfect. Abraham was far from perfect. Just one example: when traveling to Egypt, he lies to the authorities to get them to believe that Sarah is not, in fact, his wife, but his sister, and he puts her in a compromising position to save himself. Now, in my book, that's a pretty cowardly act, right? That's just, you don't do that. Come on, it's Father's Day. You're supposed to man up and look after your family. You also notice, as you read through that he acquires his initial wealth through deception. So that lie of Sarah being his sister leads to a couple of things. Pharaoh gives him sheep and cows and all sorts of things, and he builds his wealth that way. The point is that Abraham is far from perfect. He is far from holy. And yet, in Genesis 15, verse 6, the Bible tells us that Abraham believed God. He believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. So what is going on here? What is going on here? Well, if we skip back again to Genesis 12 and 3, God tells Abraham that one of his descendants would bring worldwide blessing. The world will be blessed through you, Abraham. God alludes to this again in Genesis chapter 15. You see, God gave Abraham a glimpse of the coming Messiah. He gave him a glimpse that Jesus would come through his line. And Abraham believed God. Abraham believed God. He trusted God. And that's what was credited to him as righteousness. He trusted God. Now, let me make a little pastoral note here. You may be here this morning. You might not be a Christian. You're trying to figure this whole thing out. In fact, you're kind of skeptical. Here's the thing. What I'm not talking about here is blind faith. God doesn't just want blind faith. When I was searching for myself as a teenager, I found the scripture in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18, very helpful, where God says to his people, come, let us reason together, says the Lord. Let us reason together. So there is a wrestling that sometimes we need to do. We need to understand. We need to figure things out. In fact, God starts speaking to Abraham in Genesis 12. It's only in chapter 15 that he believes and it's credited to him as righteousness. So Abraham walked a journey, and perhaps you're walking a journey this morning. That's totally fine. But here's the thing. When Abraham encountered God, when he met with God, when he looked at God and he understood he met with God, he believed God. That's what we're talking about this morning. That is what was credited to him as righteousness. And this is exactly the point that Paul is making in Romans 4. Abraham couldn't boast to God. As esteemed as Abraham was by the Jewish nation, his good works could not win him favor with God. In fact, like I said earlier, Abraham, you could describe him as a coward and a deceiver. And remember, at this point, Abraham doesn't even have the law of God to uphold. That only comes in the book of Exodus when Moses is leading the people out of Egypt. So Paul's argument here is that Abraham, the man that all Jewish people looked up to as father of the nation, was not justified by his works, but rather God is the one who declared him to be righteous. God is the one who declared him to be righteous. Remember, prior to Abraham meeting with God, he was from a pagan land, probably doing pagan things, not interested in God, doing his own thing, looking for land, looking for how to build his wealth, doing whatever he needed to do, but God is the one who moved towards him. God is the one who moved towards him in Genesis 12. It's just promise after promise. Listen to this. God speaking to Abraham, I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all the people of the earth will be blessed through you. You see where the emphasis is? It's on God. He's the one saying, I'm coming to you. You're not interested. I'm coming to you. I'm coming to bring blessing to you. Abraham's not searching for God, yet God moves towards him, God blesses him, and Abraham believed God. That's it. That's it. There's no magic trick. There's no sacrifice. There's no chant. There's no ceremony. He simply believed God. Notice the Bible doesn't say that he believed in God. In fact, the Bible tells us even the demons believe in God. Rather, it says that he believed God. It alludes to an intimate relationship of faith and trust. Now, I've been married to my wife, Lee, for 15 years, and prior to that, we knew each other for 7 years. I think I mentioned this last time. We started dating in high school. But prior to that, there was a time that I didn't know her, that I knew about her, that I knew some details about her. I believed that she existed, obviously, but I didn't know her. I couldn't claim to know what she enjoyed. I didn't know what made her laugh. I didn't know what her habits were. I didn't know what caused her anxiety. I didn't know anything of her personality. I just knew her name. I knew that she was beautiful, and I knew that she had a friend named Stacy who I should probably get to know if I wanted to become closer to Lee. Interstage Stacy. Now, the point that I'm trying to make here about knowing Lee, is that knowing about Lee and knowing Lee are two very different things, right? And in the same way, believing in God and believing him are two different things entirely. He doesn't just want us to believe in him. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. No, he wants that to be mixed with faith and to be drawn deep into our hearts. He wants us to believe him. He wants us to know him. He wants us to trust him through the person of Jesus. That's what God wants for us. So let me ask you this morning, let me ask myself this morning, Are we believing God? Are you believing God? Wesley, are you believing God? Are you living your life trusting him, being intimately connected with him? Folks, this is actually what it boils down to, really. Abraham believed God. He simply believed him. And that's what he wants for us, to trust him, to know him, to believe him. The Abraham story confirms that salvation is a matter of grace. Our sin debt is erased and we are completely free. It's a beautiful truth. God, help us. Help us believe this. Help us to own this. Now, what this doesn't mean is that as God declares Abraham righteous, that suddenly he becomes a perfect human being after meeting God. In fact, in Genesis 20, we see him doing the very thing that he did in 12 again, deceptively deceiving people, making Abimelech, I think it was, making him believe that Sarah again was his sister instead of his wife. They've moved to a different region now, and again he deceives this person in authority, telling them that Sarah was his sister. So he's a bit of a coward and a deceiver beforehand. He meets with God, and yet we still see the same trait. Why am I saying this? In fact, if you go further into the Genesis story with Abraham, you'll see that he did many other things that weren't great, even after this encounter in Genesis 15 with God. And the reason that I'm pointing this out is because much like Abraham, when God declares, or as some translation puts it, when God reckons us to be righteous by his grace through faith alone, it doesn't mean that we're made instantly perfect. It's not like there's some fairy dust that he sprinkles on us, and all of a sudden, now they come to Jesus, everything's great, until they march off into the heavenlies. No, that's not what it's about. We grow in obedience. We grow in sanctification as we walk with him, as we allow him to shape us, as we allow him to go to places in our hearts that need some panel beating and shaping, as he gets things out of us that shouldn't be there. I mean, is it just me? We very much kind of stumble and fumble our way through this walk with Jesus, don't we? I hope it's not just me, but there are times I'm sitting with my Bible and, you know, just me alone and God, I'm like, why and how do you put up with me? How is it that you are so patient and gracious with me? Because it was me sitting in your seat. Brothers and sisters, let's never forget, let's always remember that God has lavished his grace on us as a free gift. If it was given based on our works and our behavior, we would be in serious, serious trouble. And this is also the reason why he says we cannot boast. Abraham couldn't boast. He didn't come with his pack of certificates and credentials. He just came, met with God, he believed God, and God declared him righteous. Which leads us to our second point, which is that the difference between earning and deserving versus believing and receiving. Now, before Paul goes on to develop his argument about Abraham further, he takes a slight detour to focus on King David. And he first points out the difference between someone who works to earn their wages versus someone who trusts God and freely receives justification and righteousness from God. So let's just read verses 4-8 again, just to remind ourselves what he says there. From verse 4, now to the one who works, wages are not credited as a gift, but as an obligation. However, to the one who does not work, but trusts God, who justifies the ungodly, their faith is credited as righteousness. David says the same thing when he speaks of the blessedness of the one to whom God credits righteousness apart from works. Blessed are those whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sins the Lord never counts against them. Now, I have a job. I go to my place of work every weekday, and while I'm at my place of employment, I'm working through tasks, I'm delivering projects, I'm leading teams, I'm developing and executing on strategy, and for rendering those services, the company that I work for, at the end of each month, pays me a wage. They pay me my salary, and they do this every month. This is what we call a transactional relationship, right? I'm bringing something to the table, they appreciate that, and they show that appreciation by paying me a salary. The company has an obligation to pay me for the work that I've done. Now, I'm still trying to get this concept across to my children who just believe that money appears, but that is a work in progress. The point is that wages are paid as an obligation for work done. Wages are paid as an obligation for work done. And Paul is saying that that very relationship that I've just described, the transactional relationship, is the complete opposite. of how God justifies us. Completely opposite. He says that merely trusting God, the ungodly, and when we hear that, when he talks about the ungodly, he's not talking about, you know, people over there who do those things. He's talking about you and me, the ungodly. We have our accounts credited with God's righteousness merely by believing him. In other words, there's no work in it. There's nothing that we have to do. There's nothing we have to earn. We don't deserve it, and yet he gives us his righteousness. Folks, this is like wave after wave after wave of his goodness pouring out and pouring out and pouring out. And he's saying, you know what? Just when you think you've had enough, I'm going to pour out more blessing on you. I'm going to pour out more favor on you. I'm going to pour out my righteousness on you, on you, on you. Do you know why? Simply because I love you. Not because you've shown yourself to be worthy of it, but because I love you. This is the great truth of the gospel, and we don't like it, do we? Something in us wants to reject it because surely I've got to pay something. Surely I've got to feel some pain. Surely I've got to pay some price. Surely, 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 brothers and sisters, as I read through the scriptures, the answer is a resounding surely not. Surely not. It's so amazing that we actually struggle to comprehend how he can just keep on and keep on and keep on. And this is the God we serve. Even today, you may be sitting here and you may be thinking, I don't deserve anything from God. Can I tell you something? You're right. You don't. I don't. We don't deserve it. And yet he gives it to us completely and over and over and over. Paul goes on to quote David in Psalm 32, blessed are those whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord will never count against them. Now, here's the thing. This psalm was written when David had committed what seems like a pretty grievous sin, and he's in this position. He's pouring out his heart to the Lord. And in verse 5 of Psalm 32, David says that, I'm paraphrasing here, but he acknowledges his sin to the Lord. He confessed his transgressions, and the Lord forgave the guilt of his sin. So how is it that David, who clearly recognizes his sin, he recognizes he got this wrong, how is it that he can stand before God knowing that his sins are forgiven? He could enter into a place of intimate prayer, pouring out his heart to the Lord, knowing that his sin was there. But he could do this because he was clear that he was coming to God not on the basis of his works, but he was coming on the basis of trusting God. He didn't come on the basis of how well he did that week. He didn't perform a ritual. He didn't formulate a strategy. He didn't deliver a project. He simply came to God, and God poured out his forgiveness on David. No work involved. Nothing. Michael Eaton puts it this way. He says, David knew that there was righteousness available from God. David knew that forgiveness came to him by his what? His resting in the righteousness of God. His resting in the righteousness of God. And again, I say this, when we hear this, it kind of feels like, it doesn't fit, it doesn't feel right. But God crediting us with his righteousness happens on the basis of trust and belief in Jesus, not on the basis of our works. And again, I'll say, I know I sound like a stuck record here, but I think that's the point, really. Because you see, I think we have this tendency to hear this and believe it for a moment, and then a couple of days later, it's gone. We need to keep on asking God to put this into our hearts. And so this does beg the question. It does beg the question, how are we relating to God? How are you relating to God? Are you relating to him based on your performance? Or are you simply trusting him? And what's interesting to note about Psalm 32 that we just looked at is that it was written a long time after David first came to know God. And Michael Eaton notes the following. He says, David knew God as a young boy looking after the sheep in the fields of Bethlehem. But now he is writing as a mature man, as a king and leader of Israel. This is an important point. We never outgrow justification by faith. He goes on to say, when we have been Christians for half a century, we shall still be standing before God in the righteousness he gave us as much as we were on the first day we came to know him. We shall never stand before God in any other way than the way we discovered at first. We can never outgrow the righteousness of Christ. Hallelujah, amen, forever and forever, folks. It's not like, you know what, in 3 months' time, that righteousness is going to expire and you need to get something more. No, I stand on it now and I'll stand on it in eternity. Hallelujah. This is not some flaky little thing where the foundations break, and this is Jesus Christ himself saying, hey, Wesley, here is my righteousness. Take it on yourself. Take it on yourself. And he's saying that to you and to you and to you and to me. This is not shaky ground. Michael Eaton is spot on. We never outgrow justification by faith. I think what happens to us is that we start out, we believe God for the salvation of our souls, and then as we get weathered by the storms of life, as we get knocked about, that just slowly starts to change. And then we start to relate to God based on our performance. We think that we start believing ridiculous things. Oh, you know what? I didn't have my quiet time for 7 days. Now I'm surely I've disqualified myself from the blessing of God. What? Even just saying it now, it just sounds ridiculous, because if I think about it, I've got 3 children. If my son came and, you know, he just did something silly, would I stop pouring out my love towards him? I would be evil. Now, don't get me wrong. Don't get me wrong. The fact that we have access to God and can have an intimate devotional time with him and get in the quiet place with him and hear from him, that's a beautiful thing, and we should tap into that as much as we possibly can. Please, please do that. But here's the thing, if for whatever reason you haven't done it, or you, even if that extends for a week or two, it's never going to change how God relates to you. Never. We're blessed in him simply on the basis of trusting him. And I know, dude, you're saying the same thing over and over again. That's the point. That's actually the point. It's because I can tell you now, tomorrow you're going to be driving and a taxi is going to cut in front of you, and you're probably going to look at the person and then you think, oh no, God, I've failed and you don't love me anymore. And you know what? Right then in that moment, that's where the truth of God needs to come in and break and say, no, it's not on the basis of that you relate to God. It's not on that basis. It's on the firm foundation of Jesus Christ. So let me ask you again, are you trusting him? Are you trusting him? And this leads us to our third and final point, which is, getting hot in here. As we head into verse 9, the third and final point is that religious symbols do not save us. Religious symbols do not save us. As we head into verse 9, Paul returns to his initial thoughts about Abraham and is again anticipating an argument from some of his hearers, similarly to what we looked at in chapter 2, where he's addressing the issue of circumcision. Now, remember, in Paul's day, Jewish people believed that being a part of the Jewish nation guaranteed their salvation, and circumcision was a sign of that guarantee. It was the seal, as it was put. The problem with this argument is that if salvation is by faith and faith alone, then it can't be that circumcision saves, right? It's just logic. Paul continues his argument by pointing out that Abraham was reckoned righteous by God before he was circumcised. So there's, let me put it this way, it's basic math, it's simple arithmetic that's going on here, because Abraham was reckoned righteous by God in Genesis chapter 15, verse 6 to be specific, and God instituted the covenant of circumcision in Genesis 17. Now, hey, there's a lot that I don't know, okay? I love reading, I'm trying to pursue as much knowledge as I possibly can, but I do know that 17 comes after 15, right? Simple, basic arithmetic, it's there, it's in the Bible. 15 verse 6, this was credited to Abraham as righteousness, he's saved. 17, God institutes circumcision as a sign, as the seal for that, for what happened over there. It's not that circumcision that saved him. Now, in the same way, for Christians, us here today, the point is that none of our symbolic acts can save us. Now, while baptism is a beautiful outward sign of an inward work that God has done, hear me out, it does not save you. While Holy Communion is a wonderful reminder of the finished work of Jesus on the cross, the act of eating the bread and drinking the wine does not save you. Rather, Circumcision given to Abraham was a sign, it was a seal of the righteousness he had received by faith. And interestingly, Paul writes in Ephesians 1, 13 to 14, he says, "And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, when you believed. You were marked in him with what? With a seal. You were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, verse 14, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory." There's a lot that we could go into in that, but I'm just going to read this quote by Michael Eaton, which is brilliant. He says, "What seals our salvation is the outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon us. When the Holy Spirit is richly and abundantly poured out upon us, it makes it certain that we are truly Christian, and it makes us certain ourselves. The Holy Spirit witnesses to us that we are truly the children of God. You cannot be sure of your salvation just because you have one of the symbols of the church or of some Christianized nationality. You have to have faith in Jesus, the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in your heart, and the Spirit has to witness to you that you are a child of God." Isn't it wonderful that that's what he does? He pours out his Holy Spirit. The love of the Holy Spirit is poured out into our hearts. He confirms it. That's what he does. The point that Paul is making is that religious symbols and religious ceremony do not make you or me true followers of Jesus. Rather, faith in Jesus does. And this it is sealed and confirmed by the Holy Spirit being poured out and working in our lives. Now, Paul also points out that Abraham is the father, and it's important just to look at this as we come to a close. This was the kind of confusing bit that we read at the end there. Paul points out that Abraham is the father of those who are uncircumcised and yet believe. And so that's the Gentiles. And he's also the father of those who are circumcised and believe. So that's the Jewish believers. Now, Paul says this because in Abraham's story, at one point he was a believer who was uncircumcised, Genesis 15. And then later he was a believer who was circumcised, Genesis 17. Now, this is important because Abraham is a model for all believers, both Gentile and Jew. And why is he a model? He's a model in that he was saved without circumcision. He was saved without water baptism. He was saved without being a Jew. He was saved without the law of Moses. He was saved without. Abraham was justified through faith alone. He believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Brothers and sisters, that's all we've got here today. When we start to kind of put building blocks together ourselves and build up religious credentials and do all this and that and that and that makes us right with God, we're just wasting our time. As we draw to a close, I'm not sure if you guys had a chance to sing this. I asked the worship team if they could sing this song a bit earlier. But I'll just read you the lyrics because I think it wonderfully sums up the gospel message. It says, "All sufficient merit, shining like the sun, a fortune I inherit by no work I have done. My righteousness I forfeit at my Savior's cross, where all sufficient merit did what I could not. In love he condescended, eternal now in time, a life without a blemish, the Maker made to die. The law could never save us, our lawlessness had won, until the pure and spotless Lamb had finally come. It is done. It is finished. No more debt I owe. Paid in full, all sufficient merit now my own. I lay down my garments, any empty boasts, good works all corrupted by the sinful host. I'm dressed in my Lord Jesus, a crimson robe made white. No more fear of judgment. His righteousness is mine. It is done. It is finished. No more debt I owe. Paid in full, all sufficient merit, now my own." Praise God. I mean, it's really bad for traffic when I'm listening to this in my car driving to work in the morning because the tears just start to stream down. But folks, this is the truth that we just got to meditate on and ask God to mix with faith and drive deep, deep, deep into our hearts. Should we trust him? Amen. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we're just so grateful to you that you've done it all. There's nothing more that we can add. There's nothing more that we can do. And yet, Lord, so often we have the proclivity to want to try and bring our religious stuff and make We make ourselves think that that'll make you love us more when it's not the case. And Lord Jesus, we're just so grateful to you that you're so kind and you're so gracious and you're so wanting to draw us in. Help us, Lord. Help us to take this truth deep into our hearts. And maybe you're here this morning and you're on a journey, as I alluded to earlier. Maybe you're trying to figure this thing out with Jesus. Is this real? Is this not? Can I encourage you to look and search and dig? But I also want to encourage you, when you get to that point and you know he's speaking with you, don't resist him. Believe him. Move towards him. And maybe some of us here, like what Michael Eaton alluded to, you know, we've been walking with the Lord for many, many, many years. But what we've done, just because of life and experience and things that have maybe hurt us or damage that was done, we've kind of stopped believing this, and we've put some layers in between us and God, thinking that these are the things that are going to make him love us more. Can I just gently and pastorally say, just let those things go. Just put them down. Just come to Jesus as you are. Fall on the rock that is Jesus. If there's sin that you need to confess, that's okay. He's faithful and just to forgive us all our sins. But we come, Lord Jesus, we come to you this morning. We say that you are absolutely worthy. We thank you for your amazing grace to us, Lord, and we pray that you would help us to believe you just as Abraham did. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Wes. Absolutely wonderful. It is a scandal, isn't it? It's a scandal that not to the one who works, but to the one who has faith in him who justifies the ungodly, to him his faith is credited as righteousness, which means the way to go up is to go down first. And if you're, as Wes said, if you're a guest amongst us and you're thinking, actually, I do want to get right with God, don't wait until you've got everything together so that it'll be just a little leap. Acknowledge, hey, I need, and then put your trust in him. Thank you so much, Wes. That was wonderful. And you can chat about these things in the queue for coffee because our baristas are waiting to serve us. We're done in terms of the service, but church isn't over. So this is a context where you can go up to someone you don't know and you can say, hello, my name is whatever, and begin a conversation. It's allowed. So God bless you, and we'll see you next Sunday.